to the Rosh Yeshiva, to Rabbi Blau, who's here, to Rabbi Reese, who's in from Chicago, to Rabbi Wolfish. Very nice to be able to host you here, to fellow deans, members of the faculty and administration. A special welcome to the members of the Rosensweig family. It is great to, always great to be able to celebrate with you. To members of the REITS board, Rabbi Julius Berman, Rabbi Hai Arbisfeld, and family members, to Rabbi Bronstein, and a special thank you to Rabbi Yosef Kalinsky and Rabbi Yaakov Trump, who helped put together this day today. The Gemara tells us in Sota, and Rashi quotes it slightly differently, but the Gemara tells us in Sota that when Yosef was at a critical moment, he looked up and he saw the Musdiyukno Shel Aviv. As the Gemara quotes it in Sota, Bechalon. He saw through the window when he saw the Musdiyukno Shel Aviv. For the past many years that I've had the privilege to work here, every once in a while, once, twice a week, I look through the little window in my office, and there I see Tmus Diukno Shel Rabbi Dr. Rosensweig. And every time I see Rabbi Rosensweig, it is heartwarming to me because I see someone who really cares, who really wants to know how I'm doing, how the yeshiva is doing, how the college is doing. And seeing that the Musdiyukno is something that's wonderful for me to see all the time. I had the privilege of being a Talmid in Yeshiva College of Rabbi Rosensweig Sr. I had the privilege to spend many years in the shir of his son, Rav Rosensweig. I had the privilege of living close by to Rosensweig's in Jamaica Estates and have a very, very special, special connection and owe a tremendous, tremendous debt of Hakaras HaTov to Rabbi Rosensweig, to Rav Rosensweig, and to the entire family. There are a couple of things that I've learned from Rabbi Rosensweig Sr. I learned a passion for Jewish history that isn't just about getting the facts correct, which is so important, but of understanding how important it is to be a part of Jewish history, to understand what happened before us. It's not simply history. It's Jewish history. And I saw and I felt that passion in all the classes that I took with Rabbi Rosensweig when I was here as a student. But I think I've learned more from Rabbi Rosensweig since I was a student than what I learned in the classroom. I learned tremendous honor and respect for a spouse whose yahrzeit is coming up in just a few days. I learned so much about marriage from just hearing the way Rabbi Rosensweig spoke about his wife and understanding the role of a couple, a rabbinic couple. I learned about how to be a better shul rabbi. I learned some of that in the Jewish history classes, but after I became a professional, I learned how to be a much better shul rabbi from the advice, some of which I took, except the constant refrain, Mark, you gotta slow down. That I didn't do. I didn't do so well with the Mark, slow down. But I always felt that I had a figure, like a father figure, and I love to have that father figure who I know is looking over, I know is proud of me. He's proud that I went back for graduate studies in Jewish history. And I've learned so much from you and from your family. I owe much of what I have, much of what I am, to what you've created and what you've built. So I want to say thank you, and I'm so lucky that I get to be up here to be able to speak and say what everybody here really wants to say to you. It's my privilege to call upon first President Richard M. Joel, and then my Rebbe, Rav Rosensweig, to speak words of tribute.
Rabbi and Mrs. Lamb, Rashi Yeshiva, our guest of honor, forgive me for being a little late. I had a crisis to create, So a little bit, this is like when I first became president, in the first 3 or 4 months of my presidency, I was different. I was visited by different rabbis who had come to see me, sage rabbis. And on three occasions, the exact same situation occurred, which is that at one point the rabbi would say, "Would you mind if I close the door?" I said, "Fine." Then they would get up, I'd get up and close the door. I'd come back and say, "I need you to know something. I was really the one that was closest to the Rav." Right? So I was reminded as I was listening to Rabbi Penner speak, and I was thinking about what it was that I wanted to say, that I think there are many people who would close my door, come to me and say, "You know, I'm really the one closest to Rabbi Rosensweig." And I think that's because there's a genuineness, a profound personal interest that really marks it. So my comments are going to reflect, I'm sure, what all of us would say, except the family would say it even better. I was thinking of the words I wanted to use. I think the first term that came to mind in thinking about you, Rebbe, is modest exceptionalism. It's modest exceptionalism. That there is no doubt that that notion of exceptionalism, striving to be your best, not so that others are less, but to set a standard and to accept that for your family, but to do it with anivus, is what accompanies you as you walk. But then also, given what we read in the Torah without giving a Dvar Torah, we're immersed in the stories of the Avos. And at least when I think about you, you're a patriarchal figure to me, and I think to multiple communities and to countless individuals. So to be a little bit more contemporary, but not so contemporary that young people will understand me and that old people won't, when I think about you, I think about Back to the Future. I think about Back to the Future, or I guess in Hebrew, Chadesh Yomeinu Kekedem. You represent this complex and wonderful mix of values of the true Torah Umada Renaissance man, something that we all strive to create an environment of at our yeshiva. And Baruch Hashem, I think we succeed a lot, but we only succeed a lot because there are those models such as yourself who don't have to teach it, you just live it. And I think you've manifested that in your roles as rabbi, as educator, and as friend. And it's those traits, that sense of shlemut, that sense of wholeness, that sense of balance, that sense of nuance, that sense of pride without pridefulness, that we so desperately need in looking to the future. We have to look back to the future. And we have to make sure that that's the reigning aspiration that we have. I guess another way to say it is that I would call you an old soul. Okay? Please God, I should merit that kind of a description. Like a fine wine, it has different dimensions and just the right sweetness and nuance and flavorings and kick too, that makes it so wonderful. So that's what I would say about the wonderful teacher. For me, this is a very personal moment, and I'm honored to have the opportunity to speak this way. I can talk about the great rabbinic career, his brilliance, the extraordinary family he's raised, the manner in which the kiyum of how you've raised your family is who your grandchildren are, and what a statement that is. Your work in developing the AP, the Jewish History AP, and how proud you were of both developing it and administrating it. Your teaching of Jewish history, which you don't believe is history, you believe it's inviting your students into a contemporary narrative, because we are of memory and not of history. But I'd rather focus on two matters in closing. One of the traits that defines any university presidency is the loneliness of the presidency. I have had my revered predecessor, Dr. Lamb, to help me bridge that loneliness, because generally, there's nothing I've experienced that he hasn't and can give me reassurance on that. And of course, there's always my Esther. But I have to say, there are very few who generously step forward and are there to be your friend and your guide and to create a safe place where you get to just be Richard. And from the beginning, you offered yourself that way just by being. Just by being. And you've been to me a Rav and a friend and a confidant and a guide with warmth, with support, with challenge, with intelligence. And that means more than anything. And please God, that'll continue, Bezohundumsvansik, and then we'll renegotiate. The other piece that means so much is the model that you and Miriam, Zichron Alevrecha, were and continue to be for Esther and me. Very much a classical love story, very much a partnership, very much a defining feature of their lives as how they defined themselves, each other, and how other people defined their relationships with the two of you. The combination of commitment and integrity and humor is just a wonderful model of a couple and a wonderful model for us all to seek to emulate. And as we always speak, as desperately as you miss her, and we all do, how alive she remains through you and your children. So this is not a goodbye. I mean, these are not hespedim, God forbid. But this is an acknowledgement, and frankly, it's part of our educational mission. It's a lesson to all of us as we reflect on who you are, who you continue to be. And as you go into the next chapter of your relationship with all of us and with Yeshiva University, you should know that all of us who will continue to have the benefit of you consider ourselves privileged.
First, I want to begin by thanking all those who really had this wonderful idea for tribute, well-deserved tribute for my father, for his many years of involvement in the yeshiva, and really celebrating, as we'll just speak about very briefly in a moment, really a lifetime in Yeshiva Sarbeni Yitzchak Elchanan and in Yeshiva University, you know, from the time that he was 17, 18, really till now and continuing forward. So really it was, it deserves a real big yashar koach to Rabbi Kalinsky, who really oversaw the coordination of all of this. Rabbi Yaakov Trump, who worked on the slide presentation, which I also want to thank my sister for. I also want to acknowledge the presence of family members. It's in the middle of the day, so not everybody could be here, but we have representatives from everybody. My sister came all the way from Israel, or the RCA, or one or the other, just to be here. And we have grandchildren, and I see great-grandchildren in the audience as well. So really, it's a very special day, and it's a very special tribute, and we don't take it lightly and for granted. We appreciate it very, very much. The truth is that my own role here today is primarily that of a son, clearly, but I also wear multiple hats. Perhaps the most important one, not everybody is familiar with, my father certainly is, and that I'm at least, you know, half the time the chauffeur for getting my father to and from yeshiva. But obviously more important than that is to represent the family. I'm here and therefore a natural representative, but any of the family members really would be just as effective, because my father sets the tone in so much of who we are and what our interests are, what our values are. So I'm happy to be the representative. But clearly, in addition to that, being the one who is here, you know, there's a real sense of Vayelchu Shneim Yachdav, an odyssey, a journey that began, you know, for my father many, many, many decades ago, but has also been my own odyssey in my own way, you know, for some decades as well. And that's really an extraordinary experience to share. We'll say something about that as well. In addition, I'm happy to see myself as a representative of the Beis Medrash and the Rosh Yeshiva at this gathering. Part of my father's special legacy is his ability to span and to bridge and really to integrate all of the different parts of what make our yeshiva special, but to do it in a magnificently integrated way. And his relationship as a Talmud with his Rebbeim, President Joel made reference already to the special relationship with the Rav, which is something that deserves a lot of discussion. But not only the Rav, Rav David Lifshitz and Rav Shatzkis, Zecharno Livracha. I remember very, graphically, my father's special relationship with some of the very intriguing, fascinating members of the faculty that other people's parents didn't have relationships with, Rav Gorelick and Rav Borenstein, people who had special affection for my father because of his integrity. And he really comes from that world. He's somebody who I know my a little bit older colleagues look to as a colleague, Rav Tendler and others. Schechter, my father, used to sit in the back of the rebel classes. I'm not sure if they were paying attention. I think they were maybe involved in other more important matters. But these relationships, and then of course with the next generation, the generation that is younger than me, Rav Simon, and not by that much, but who were Talmidim of his and students of his Jewish history class, but who understood that this relationship isn't, as was noted earlier by both Rabbi Penner and President Joel, not just about Jewish history, but really about Torah and about life. So representing the yeshiva, the Beis Medrash, is something very appropriate as well. The truth is that the hosting of this, not by Yeshiva College, of which my father is proudly an important member, but by the Torah Studies Department, by Rabbi Penner and Rabbi Kalinsky, etc., is of course extremely appropriate. Because my father's true legacy here is that ability to span and to bridge and to integrate these various worlds. You know, we have so much under the so-called tent, which is magnificent, and which is impressive. But there really are very few people who belong in all those worlds and who belong in all of them comfortably. And my father really is one of those people. And it's something which is rare, and it's something which really requires a tribute and a celebration. He's been able to be a part of the Beis Medrash, which is really what defines him, his relationship with the Rav, his learning, his Rabbanus, but in a fully integrated way, to take that passion and those values and to be able to translate them as a professor in the college and elsewhere. Those of us who know the tensions and the challenges of integrating the world of the Beis Medrash with the world of the academy know that there are a lot of, there's a lot of fallout along the way. And even people who manage it often manage it in a very compartmentalized fashion. But I can say, both as an objective observer and as a subjective and admiring son, that my father, I can't recall a single self-conscious moment when he's had any difficulty with any of these hats. And really, that's an amazing legacy. The truth is that, for him, the style and the substance, the friendliness, the affection, the relationships that he's had with his students, which he calls his Talmidim, and they call him sometimes Rabbi, is an amazing thing. But it's not just the style, it's not just a question of personality, it's their sense, too, that his teaching of Jewish history is something which is really ensconced in and continues to feed from his relationship with his Rebbeim and from that Beis Medrash. It's not a coincidence that many of the Rebbeim have sent to their own children to my father's Jewish history classes, not just because it's safe and kosher, but because it really integrates the best of scholarship, but from the perspective and the prism of what's acceptable for Torah, and therefore really magnificently captures what the yeshiva's aspiration and ambition is all about. Knowing the red lines, knowing clearly what the ideological direction is, and being able to pursue that with integrity of scholarship and with a passion which is rooted in Talmud Torah. And that's really something that is very extraordinary. I think it's something that his Rebbeim discerned in him as a student, They knew that he was loyal. They knew that he was somebody who wanted to be Mekabel, all of that. And it's something which, again, I witnessed certainly with the Rav and the Lifshitz and some of the other Rebbeim. You know, as the years went by, they had a tremendous amount of pride in his ability, you know, to be constructive in this area where often there are all sorts of tensions and difficulties. It's a fascinating thing. You know, the Gemara speaks about the relationship between a parent and a Rebbe. And the Gemara says that all things being equal, when you have somebody who's clearly, you know, the Rebbe and a father who is a father but not a Rebbe, you stand up for and give greater kavod, you know, to the Rebbe, because he's somebody who's mevio l'chai olam haba, whereas a father is somebody who's mevio l'chai olam hazeh. When somebody is both, you know, a Rebbe and a father, the situation is more complicated. But I don't want to speak about myself. What's remarkable to me is that throughout the years, I bumped into many of my father's students. I share many students, which is a special special dimension in our relationship as well. And to them, he's really a Rebbe. And they speak of him that way as well. They stand up when he walks into the class. They really see him as an extension of their Torah studies. And that's a remarkable, remarkable thing for somebody whose integrity, in terms of scholarship, has not been compromised, ki hu zeh. The truth is that my father is part of a very special group, of which Rabbi Lamb and Rabbi Roth and Rabbi Wurzburger, Zichrono Livracha, and others, the rabbi doctor generation, really who were manhigim, they were, you know, rabbanim in the field. They really transformed American Jewry. You know, we're all benefiting from the fruits of their labor now. We take so much for granted in terms of what Torah life is in America and in the world. But these are the people who created it, and they created it in a very unique fashion, these people in particular, by being able to synthesize. I used to speak here about synthesis. I don't know what happened to the term over the years. Maybe Rabbi Lamb has some thoughts about it. Maybe people began to think that it was too synthetic. But whether it's integration or synthesis, these are really people who represented that. And it wasn't just that they were educated in two worlds and found, you know, the vocabulary to convey that and to express that to their Talmidim. It was precisely the fact that they were Rabbanim in the field, that they dealt with families, that they built Jewish life in America, and yet they had the integrity and the ability, right, to influence in the classroom and to, you know, present a scholarship through the prism of Torah. That was really a very powerful combination, which transformed our institution and really transformed world Jewry in the process. We don't have enough of that today, and the inspiration of people like my father is something which Yemir Tashem will continue to revive and to develop that much further. Let me just conclude by saying that, you know, obviously I'm here to speak not only as one of the Rabbeim and as somebody who's been in the institution for a long time, but especially as a son. It's not necessary to go through the resume of my father's children and grandchildren, beginnings already of some great-grandchildren. It's very obvious that his interests and the integrity that he brought to pursuing those interests, manhigus in the community, scholarship, learning in the Beis Medrash, that impact has been felt profoundly throughout our entire family, all branches of the family. The fact that in my personal branch, we're able to be zocha every month to a four-generation lunch, you know, is something which is truly extraordinary as well. And in terms of myself, you know, having been inspired from a very young age to pursue rabbanus of some sort, and you know, inspired by you know, the Shabbos Shuvah drashas and Shabbos Hagadol drashas, as to what the majesty and grandeur of Talmud Torah at a high level looks like and the impact that it can have. But especially, again, the idea of integrating with integrity the combinations, it's really had a profound effect on me and my family, on our entire extended family. Eila told us Yitzchak ben Avraham, Avraham holidas Yitzchak, as we always say, that double formulation tells you that the relationship isn't just biological, it's spiritual, but even more than that, it's precisely the differences in the personalities and in the life experiences of Avram and Yitzchak that make that second statement, Avram Holidas Yitzchak, even more powerful. So as we move to our next stage, and again, it is only a transition, we're going to find ways to make accessible my father's legacy in Jewish history, and his leadership, also to continue to be felt in the halls of our Beis Medrash, our college, our yeshiva. So it's really a special privilege to be able to wish him that he continue to go mechayel al chayel, that it's Eila told us, not only for our family, but for the yeshiva's family as well. Thank you.
What's so special about today is that although we're celebrating 38 years of teaching, so many years of accomplishment in the rabbinate, we are not celebrating what you were, but we're celebrating what you are. And that's what makes today really so special. To see all of those things, all of those sides of you, and to see, and to be able to celebrate them all together. It's my pleasure to call up Rabbi Dr. Beryl Rosensweig. Before you speak, we have a plaque for you.
Oh my goodness,
yeah, it's actually very nice.
And I'm reading this on behalf of really all of your Talmidim, myself included. I just have the privilege to be the one who gets to read it. To our teacher and mentor, Morenu Rabbeinu, Rabbi Dr. Bernard Rosensweig, saluting four decades of dedicated and devoted teaching, sincere commitments to students, and ever-inspiring insights at Yeshiva University. Yud Tes Kislev, Tav Shin Ayin Hei.
Thank you so much. Camera.
Yeah, you know, you've done this before. Yeah.
More than once. Okay.
So, Chairman, friends, Javier, President Joe, and all of you who have come. First of all, let me tell you that my wonderful wife, Miriam Zichrona Lebracha, would have enjoyed this immensely. She was a remarkable lady. I was a very fortunate man. In Baruch Hashem, we raised 5 wonderful children. And we see grandchildren and great-grandchildren, all of whom are walking in the direction that make us very, very proud. Listening to all of these speeches is humbling indeed. And yet really it involves much more than myself personally. It involves an idea and a concept and a thought that makes our yeshiva university very, very unique, very special rather, and unique. I was born and I grew up in Toronto. As a boy, I went to a yeshiva. There were no day schools in my time. So the yeshiva that I went to was in the afternoon. In fact, there were two yeshivas, and the two afternoon yeshivas. You always need one yeshiva that you don't go to. The Rosh Yeshiva of the other yeshiva was Rabbi Yaakov Kamenetsky, Zecher Tzadik Levracha. I went to a Polish yeshiva. And Rabbi Avraham Aaron Price, Zecher Tzadik Levracha, the author of a number of volumes of Mishnas of Rome, who was a Talmud of the Avnei Nezer, was my Rebbe. And then, at the age of 17, I came here to New York in the year 1944. I had read about this institution called Yeshiva College. It wasn't Yeshiva University at that time, Norman, or Jared, or Richard. It was simply a college. It didn't even have accreditation fully yet, even in that respect. But the idea of this combination of learning Torah and getting the kind of education that you want, and getting it on a very decent level, overwhelmed me. It wasn't easy. It wasn't easy for my parents to let me go. It wasn't easy for me to come. It was a depression. We had no money. But I made it. And the institution was wonderful to me. I had disclosed on one level in terms of the yeshiva. I came, if I had a lot of time, I'd tell you a lot of stories as we go, but we don't have that much time. There's still a luncheon upstairs in the other building. But I came here, and the president of the yeshiva at that time was Rabbi Dr. Samuel Belkin. He gave me the prina himself because the Mashkiach at the time, his name was Rav Weil, Zecher Tzadik Levracha. I never saw him, he was very sick. He was an old man, he was sick. And after he gave me the prina, there's a whole story that goes with that, which I'm not going to tell you now. He put me into Ovshatsky's year. I learned with Ovshatsky's for 2 years. It was a tremendous struggle. So he was a longer love. I also learned with Lavlicious, but Lavlicious I learned Cholin. We all did at that time, if you remember correctly. And then after that came the greatest revelation of my life. I went into the Rosh Yeshiva and spent the rest of my years of yeshiva in his yeshiva. The Rosh was awesome. And I want to tell you something. In order to understand this, there's a Gemara. The Gemara says that Harbe Lamadati Mirabosai Yosef Mechaverai Mitalmidai Yosef Mikulo. But I learned a great deal from my teachers, even more from my colleagues, and most of all from my students. And that applies exactly to me. I went into the Rosh Shir and it was an experience, literally. In the Rosh Shir, it was, every time you sat down, it was awesome. Just listening to the Rav develop his ideas in the Brisker Derech and doing it on such a level and doing it so effortlessly was remarkable. In the Rosh Shir, I met some wonderful young people. Rabbi Dr. Norman Lamb. Rabbi Dr. Saul Roth. Rabbi Dr. Moshe Tendler. These are names that are known to all of you on different levels. And certainly last but not least here, Rabbi Yumi Wolfish, who's here with his wife, Israel, today. And all of us had this marvelous experience. It was a remarkable group of boys, and they were exposed to something that was very special in every sense of the word. The nicest thing for me was that for whatever reasons, the Rav liked me a little bit, more than a little bit, I think. And the greatest blessing was that over the years, the Rav very generously continued to be my guide and my mentor. Gave me the direction that I needed on so many different occasions throughout the years. I was lucky with my Rabbi. But I was even luckier with my Chaver. Norman Lamb and Saul Roth and Yumi Wolfish and Moshe Tendler. Norman, incidentally, was more than just a friend, he was my roommate for 3 years. And his parents were wonderful to me. I came here, I had absolutely nobody. There wasn't a single relative in New York that I had. And his parents took me in and made me feel comfortable at all times. It was not a small thing. I had wonderful colleagues in the rabbinate. At one time, I had the source of being the president of the RCA in 1978 to 1980, I believe. I worked with young, wonderful rabbis. And I think in those years, we achieved something. I think, Yumi, you came in just at the tail end of my term in office. but it was something that I never forgot. But my connection to the yeshiva was a constant one. Yeshiva has had four presidents. And I fortunately have known three of them. I knew Dr. Belkin. With Dr. Belkin, I was friendly. But with Rabbi Dr. Lamb and Rabbi and President Richard Joel, I'm not friendly at all. We're friends. And that means a great deal to me. Norman did a wonderful job as president of the university. And it's carried on by Richard Joel, who is a true friend of mine to this day as well. And I wish him hatzlacha. It's not a difficult, not an easy task that he's undertaken at this stage. But with God's help, I hope that he will go Michael Koyo and financially bring this institution back to the luster that it always has had. The boys of this institution are special. It's Mitamidai Yosem Nikulo. They're a remarkable group of boys. I love teaching. I love teaching Jewish history. But above all, I love teaching Jewish history to the boys in Yeshiva College. They're a challenge. They're demanding. As a matter of fact, as some of them look at me when I teach, I'm the only one in the faculty, I think, who teaches all three courses, the basic courses, classical Jewish history, medieval Jewish history, and modern Jewish history. Anyways, I remember once that I was teaching classical, which is ancient, so to speak, Second Commonwealth, etc., Jewish history. One of my students said to me with a smile on his face, "You probably lived through it." And I smiled and I said, "Probably." The truth of the matter is that I feel very much a part of what I teach, no matter what level or what time period. Because my feeling is that next to learning Gemara and Jewish history is absolutely essential to understand what a Jew is all about and what Judaism really means. And my greatest joy is bumping into students years later and having them come over to me and tell me with great joy that they've kept the notes and that they look through them from time to time. Not a small thing. The yeshiva is an extraordinary amalgam. We should be grateful that it's here. Do everything in our power to make sure that it will always be here. This kind of combination is essential for the future of the Jewish people. What we have done, hopefully, is only the beginning. With God's help, we will go forward and continue to provide the kind of integrated education that can only lead L'Hagdil Torah U'Hadira. I thank you very much, all of you, for those of you who came. I don't know whether I'm worthy, but I do know that I'm grateful. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you.
This includes the formal part of the program. For those who are here and RSVP'd, the lunch, the location was changed from upstairs due to the number of people who will be joining us to First Hall, room 535, just across the street in First Hall on the fifth floor. That's where the...